ओम ज्ञानतिमिरन्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकाय चक्षुरुन्मिलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः नमः ॐ विष्णुपादाय कृष्णपृष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्त स्वामी इति नामिने नमस्ते सारस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानन्द श्री अद्वैत गदाधार श्रीवासादि गौरभक्तवृन्द हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम हरे कृष्ण आई थैंक ऑल ऑफ यू फॉर कमिंग टुडे इवनिंग एंड आई विल बी स्पीकिंग टुडे ऑन द टॉपिक ऑफ इमोशनली हेल्दी स्पिरिचुअलिटी So this emotionally healthy has two meanings to it. That subtitle I had given was that protecting our emotional health while pursuing our spiritual health. So I'll start with an incident which inspired me to take this topic, and I'll elaborate as we move forwards. I answer questions on my website, thespiritualscientist.com. And when Mataji was just becoming a devotee, she posted a question. She said that she, from her childhood, suffered from paranoia, chronic fearfulness. She would get very scared of things. She would see a car crash and she would say, I'm going to crash next time. And she had to go to a therapist and take treatment. And she was able to manage herself. And then she came to Krishna consciousness, started chanting Hare Krishna, and she found her fear also went down by that. But once she attended a class, and the class theme was that death can come at any time. And the whole class basically was describing various ways in which death can come anytime. In fact, that devotee also showed a video in which the whole video was a compilation of how people who were living normally, somebody was just in a shopping mall, walking along, and suddenly they get a heart attack. And then they die over there. Somebody is sitting and watching TV, they just press a remote, and that time something happens. And they, from the remote, they get an electric shock and they die. So he said that, from just seeing that video, hearing about the various possibilities, about how death can come at any time, that triggered my fearfulness once again. So badly that I again had to go to my therapist. And I had been treated quite well, so my therapist asked me what happened. When I told her therapist, she said that, you know, hearing such classes is psychologically damaging for you. So stop hearing them. He said that, I thought the Bhagavad Gita is actually very good wisdom. So is hearing the Bhagavad Gita psychologically damaging? It's a Gita class that I heard. So then I explained elaborately that actually there is goodness, passion and ignorance. The three modes of material nature. And these shape our perception. So for example, if I am in goodness, when I hear about death, the way I respond to it will be different. When I'm in passion, the response will be different. When I'm in ignorance, the response will be different. So if I am in the mode of passion, goodness, if I hear about death, then I start thinking, yeah, death means that whatever I am working for will be destroyed. So is there anything beyond this? And if there is, how can I achieve it? So in goodness, we see the material and we see the spiritual. And then the temporality, the ephemerality of the material prompts us to look at the spiritual. In contrast, if we are in the mode of passion, then we think the material is all that exists. And we will think that, okay, now that I have the material and I'm going to die anytime, let me enjoy as much as I can. So, the same fact, in goodness, you may say, everything is temporary. Why waste your time in enjoying things? Why waste your time in getting entangled? So, in passion, you say, everything is temporary. Why lose the opportunity for enjoyment? In fact, Ravana told this to Sita. He says, youth is temporary, your beauty is temporary. If you spend 14 years in exile with Ram, your youth will go away. Come and enjoy with me. So I once saw an advertisement when I was going to Mayapur in Calcutta. It was, enjoy before you become a dirty old man. So yes, you're going to become old. So in passion, we think that I have to enjoy right away because the matter is all that I can see. And let me control as much as I can, as long as I can, and enjoy. So, in the mode of ignorance, when we hear about death, we in goodness, we see some things are in my control, some things are not in my control. So let me focus on that which is in my control. So the material level, death is going to come, that is not in my control. But the spiritual level, life is eternal, I am eternal. Let me raise my conscience to the spiritual level. In the mode of passion, I think I am the controller, or I want to be the controller. And I try as much as possible to control things. In the mode of ignorance, I don't know about the spiritual realm. And even in the material level, I think I am not in control. I can't control anything. So that makes me feel powerless. So in the mode of ignorance, people go into lamentation. Oh, you know, this goes wrong, that goes wrong. Moroseness. Moroseness means habitual negativity. Every suggestion we give to a person who is morose, they will find all the problems that are possible with it. It's not going to work. It's not going to work. So we go into the zone of self-pity. So if somebody is in the mode of ignorance and we tell them that death can come anytime, that can make them paranoid. Oh, death can come at any time. Death can come at any time. And what should I do? How should I live? Everything will be destroyed at any moment. So the purpose of everything given in scripture is to spiritualize our consciousness. Spiritualizing our consciousness means that we want to prompt our consciousness towards spiritual reality. So now, the defining principle in bhakti is anukulyasya sankalpa pratikulyasya varjinam. Accept that which is favorable, avoid that which is unfavorable. So in the philosophy also, we have to find out what prompts our consciousness towards Krishna. And we focus on that. So if because of my paranoia, my fearfulness, I find that hearing about death agitates me, it makes me paranoid, and that means that hearing is not favorable for my Krishna bhakti. So it is not that hearing the Bhagavad Gita is psychologically damaging. Rather, hearing some aspects of the Bhagavad Gita may be damaging for those who are already psychologically damaged. So, it's not that being psychologically damaged is a character deficiency. It's just the way we are. And if I am psychologically having some damage, then I have to acknowledge that and I have to do other things in Krishna Bhakti. So Srila Prabhupada even gave the example that if we hear about the Ras Leela, which is the most exalted pastime of Krishna, it is considered a worshipable pastime of pure spiritual love between Krishna and his highest devotees. But if hearing about the Ras Leela, we start equating it with ordinary male-female interactions, and that triggers our mundane desires within us, then Prabhupada said, don't hear about it. You're not yet ready. So it's like, that is the reality, and the relationships in this world are like the reflection. So now for the pure devotees, when they see the reality and they understand that is the reality, then even when they see male-female interactions, Rupa Goswami prays that, oh my dear Lord, just as just as a boy's mind is attracted to a girl's, boy's mind is attracted to a girl, and a girl's mind is attracted to a boy. Yuti naam yatha yunau cha yutim tatha, mano bhiramate tatra, mano me ramatam tvai. Similarly, O Lord, let my mind get be attracted to you. That means, seeing the male-female romantic interactions over here, a devotee remembers, oh, this is the reflection, that is the reality. So the reflection reminds us of the reality. But if we are not yet philosophically convinced, if we are too materially attached, then instead of the reflection reminding us of the reality reminds us of the reflection. So then what happens? Hearing about those pastimes triggers our mundane desires. If that is happening, then that means right now, I'm not mature enough to hear this. So let me purify myself, let me deepen my philosophical understanding, and then I'll be able to hear it. So the point of emotionally healthy spirituality is that our spirituality is meant to ultimately restore us to spiritual health. But along with that, we also have to progress towards spiritual health in a way that is emotionally healthy for us. That doesn't make us inordinately emotionally agitated. So I'll compare this with physical health. All of us may have certain physical health issues. Say if somebody has some back problems because of it, they can't sit on the floor. And if you tell them that you have to sit on the floor, and they sit on the floor somehow, and even if they're chanting the japa or they're hearing a class, at that time, the irritation, the pain in the body is so much that it distracts them from hearing the message, from focusing on the message. So the physical, our purpose is not to pamper the body. Our purpose, somebody says, unless there is air conditioning in the temple hall, I'm not going to come to hear any classes. Well, okay, you can have air conditioning. But the point is not whether the air conditioning is not there. We are not coming to the temple to be physically comfortable. Our purpose is that we want to gain spiritual understanding. But if for gaining spiritual understanding, our particular body needs particular things because it has some sensitivities, then addressing them so that we can focus on Krishna, that is what is simply a practical necessity. So we don't want to on one side pamper our body, but on the other side, we don't want to torture our body also. We don't work for the body, we don't work against the body. We work with the body for Krishna. So just as if it's very hot, you turn on a fan, you turn on an AC, and then continue hearing, continue practicing bhakti. If there's no fan available, then still I will tolerate it, I will do practice my bhakti. But the point of physical austerity is not to torment the body. The point of physical austerity is to increase our focus on Krishna. If somebody is fasting Nirjalon Ekadashi and they think, you know, if I'm a serious devotee, then that means I should be able to fast Nirjalon Ekadashi. We sit fast Nirjalon Ekadashi and we're sitting and chanting. And we're chanting Hare Krishna at our tongue. But the mind is chanting Prasad, 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 Hare Krishna, Prasad, 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 Prasad. Now, when will I eat? When will I eat? When will I eat? So it's like the tongue is on one track, the mind is on another track. And our consciousness is caught only in the mind. If that is happening, better take some food and then come back and chant attentively. Isn't it? The point is not to torment the body. Now, is it a character deficiency that some devotees are able to fast more, some devotees are able to fast less? It's not a character deficiency. Why? Because from the Ayurvedic perspective, different people have different bodies. There's a kapha, vata, pitta. Three kinds of bodies are there. And people with kaphic bodies can fast relatively easily. People with pitta bodies, they find it very difficult to fast. They start getting acidity and irritability. Just can't fast. So, now the important thing is to focus the mind on Krishna. And if I have a body that can't fast much, that's fine. It's not that I have to feel inferior because I can't fast. It is not that I have to minimize. We should not minimize others also. You know, you have a cough body, that's why you are able to fast. There's nothing special about it. No, there's some austerity required, and those who are doing austerity, we appreciate that. But the point is not how much I fast. The point is how much I focus on Krishna. So, now some people may be able to do it less, some people may be able to do it more. So the same principle we have to apply to our mind and our emotions. All of us have our own emotional nature. Emotional nature means some people need more of a bonding. Now, they if they come to a place, they want people to talk nicely with them. They want to interact with people. They want to sit and talk. And that's when somebody talks, they talk with each other, they feel, oh, somebody cares for me over here. And some people, they just want to talk business. It's not that they don't care, just they don't care to sit and talk too much. Now, for a person who likes to sit and talk and discuss, and that's what gives them value. And for somebody else who says that, you know, come on, let's do the things now. What are we going to do? Let's do this, 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 this. Now, when the two people are meeting of this nature, so some people are of the nature of doing things, some people are of talking. Now, it's not that one is bad or the other is good. It's just that two are of different natures. And each nature has to find how it can be addressed. So some people have a nature to bond and talk more. Then they have to find other devotees who like to bond and talk more. That doesn't mean that we sit and gossip. Now, what we talk is important, but that's a separate issue. If that's what they need, that's what they need. If somebody just can't sit and do that, let's do things. Then you have to find out, okay, how can I do? Okay, let's meet other devotees who also like to do things. And then we interact, you know, I did this, oh, I did this. Okay, well, let's move forward and let's do these things. Both of them, so some people get a sense of value based on, you know, how much time I spend with people, how much time people interact with me. Some people get a sense of value by, you know, what all I have I done. I done this, 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 this. So now we all are of different natures. Some people, you know, when some small thing goes wrong, they just get too disturbed. Some people, big things go wrong, they say they come. Now you could say that, okay, this person gets so disturbed, so sentimental. This person doesn't get disturbed at all. This person is more emotionally mature, more spiritually advanced. Well, it could be because of spiritual advancement, but it just could be because of one's own nature. So, when we don't acknowledge our physical nature, say for example, even if I have a back problem, I decide I'm going to sit on the ground and I'm going to chant. I may chant, but I'm not able to focus on Krishna. And secondly, I'm worsening my physical condition. So similarly, if we don't acknowledge our emotional nature, whatever it is, if a small thing agitates me, okay, that's the way I am. Then I just meet some devotee who speaks some kind words, so few encouraging words, few understanding words that calms me down, and then I can get on with things. So if I totally try to deny or reject my particular nature, be it physical or emotional, then two things happen. First is I can't focus on Krishna even if I try to. And second is that I aggravate my own situation. My back pain is not going to go away. But it's going to be there and it's going to worsen. So like that, if I'm agitated by something and I try to do some devotional activity, I may simply worsen my agitation and I'm not actually focusing on Krishna. So we need to acknowledge our particular nature and do what it takes to work for Krishna with that nature. So if a devotee is very fearful, then talking about how death can occur at any moment, that is simply going to agitate that devotee. And yes, so now to say, oh, why are you so fearful? Just take shelter of Krishna. That devotee may chant Hare Krishna, but they'll not be able to focus on Krishna. So we all come from our individual backgrounds. And we are not prisoners of our past. That means just because I was fearful of the, I was always very fearful, paranoid, that doesn't mean that I'll always stay fearful. We are not prisoners of our past. We can change. But at the same time, although we are not prisoners of our past, we are products of our past. And denying that we are the products of our past doesn't change us. We have to work with whatever body-mind resources we do have. So, when Abhimanyu passes away, Abhimanyu is killed, Arjuna is furious. Arjuna, just when he comes to know, he's shocked. He starts crying, collapses on the ground. And then, after that, he gets up and he lashes out at everyone. He lashes out at his brothers. He says, Yudhishthir, Bhima, Nakula, Sahadev. He said, what are your weapons? Are they simply bangles? All of you couldn't protect my son? He just lashes out at everyone and eventually turns to Krishna and he says, Krishna, you must have known what was happening. Why? Why didn't you stop? Why didn't you tell me? Why didn't you do something about it? Now, here, in fact, there is a whole half a chapter in the Mahabharata which describes Arjuna's lamentation. And Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita has said beforehand that, you know, a person in knowledge is not attached. And specifically Krishna uses the word putra dara graha adishu. One is not attached to one's children, one's son, one's spouse, and one is raktir anabhishvanga putra dara graha adishu. Now Krishna does not say, hey, Arjuna, have you forgotten the Bhagavad Gita? Should I tell you the verse? It is 13.10. Krishna doesn't do that at all. Krishna is simply there with him, gentle. Oh, Arjuna, Krishna tells, you know, your brothers are drowning in an ocean of grief, just as you are drowning. Don't speak words which will make them sink deeper into the ocean of grief. A person of character tries to decrease other people's grief, not increase it. Arjuna, summon your strength of character and pull yourself together. We are all with you. So Arjuna, so Krishna doesn't use philosophy at that time to wish away Arjuna's emotions or to minimize Arjuna's emotions. Krishna acknowledges those emotions, but Krishna encourages Arjuna to rise upwards. Similarly, when Draupadi is dishonored, after that, when they are in the forest, Krishna comes to meet them. And Draupadi has tears in her eyes. He says, Krishna, when this disaster was happening, where were you? I called you, Krishna, where were you? Now, we know that Krishna manifested as the unlimited sari which protected her honor. But it is not that Krishna was seen at that time. It was just that her sari became inexhaustible. So nobody saw Krishna. So, and they thought that this was because she was so chaste that she was by higher power, she was miraculously protected. So then Krishna, what does he answer? Krishna says, my plan is perfect, don't doubt my plan. Krishna doesn't say that. Krishna says, know, I didn't know what was happening. She said, I was in Dwarka, protecting Dwarka from the demon Shalva. He had attacked the ferocious army and I was protecting and restoring Dwarka. And as soon as I came to know, I have come immediately. Oh, Panchali, those who have wronged you will be punished. You are the daughter of a great king. You are the wife of great heroes. For those who are great, even great calamities do not disturb them. Hold patience. Have patience, O Panchali. The wrongs will be righted. So here again, Krishna does not deny her emotions. Krishna acknowledges those emotions. Sometimes we may misapply the philosophy to minimize or reject people's emotions. The purpose of the philosophy is to actually help people come closer to Krishna from where they are. If we don't acknowledge where they are, and then we use a one-size-fits-all. Some people, they just know one or two points, and whenever they meet anyone, it's like a tape recorder starts. So speak this. Now, it's good that we repeat what we have heard, but as we learn, we realize that we have to speak according to desha kala patra, according to type, place, circumstance. So, with respect to, I'll talk first about preaching to new people, and then I'll talk about interacting among devotees. So it is said, preaching means to comfort the afflicted and to afflict the comforted. That means that if somebody, their loved one has passed away and they're afflicted now. So what do? Comfort the afflicted. We tell them the soul is eternal and the soul is always under the care of Krishna. Wherever they have gone, Krishna is there with them. And Krishna is there in your hearts also. If you pray to Krishna, the results of their prayers can go to them also. So we comfort the afflicted. On the other hand, preaching also means afflict the comforted. If somebody thinks that, oh, I am wealthy, I am young, I am handsome, I am beautiful, I am successful, why do I need God? I said, you know, all that you have, it can go in one moment. Prabhupada would give the example of JFK, America's president. He was so young, powerful, handsome, popular, and just one moment he died. And Prabhupada said, death can come at any time and nothing will be left with you. Mrityu sarva harascha. Everything will be taken away. So we have to remind them that whatever you have, it's temporary. So if somebody is comforted, it's to afflict the comforted. So that's how they become aware. It's like sickness. Now if a patient is sick, the doctor has to assure the patient, yes, the sickness is there, I understand the pain is there, but you take this treatment, it will be all right. So we comfort one who is afflicted. But somebody who is in the mode of denial, you know, nothing is wrong with me. You tell them, you know, this is a serious disease, and if you don't take care of this, you know, in 3 months, you will be bedridden. In 4 months, you may become paralyzed. In 6 months, you will die. He says, are you a doctor or are you a demon? What are you doing? No. But that's what is required at that time. The purpose is the patient needs to be told seriously to take the treatment. So sometimes the afflicted need to be comforted, and sometimes the comforted need to be afflicted. Now, if we have a one-size-fits-all formula, then we end up afflicting the afflicted and comforting the comforted. So somebody has lost their loved one, and we tell them, you know, you have lost this loved one, you're going to lose all your loved ones. Life is temporary, all relationships are temporary. This world is dukkhalayam. You have experienced misery now, just see in future what miseries will come. This is a total
misapplication of the philosophy.
So, yes, a patient is sick and the sickness may worsen. But the doctor's purpose is to inspire the patient to take the medicine. So if that purpose is clear, then that same doctor may sometimes comfort the patient and sometimes may castigate the patient, afflict the patient. So we cannot use a one-size-fits-all formula. We have to be sensitive to the particular situation and present things accordingly. Sometimes we may just comfort those who are comforted. Somebody person is very proud, very arrogant, so wealthy. Just pamper them for their wealth. And maybe we just get some donation from them. Yes, we want to, if at least they're not ready to serve Krishna, we may use their Lakshmi and Krishna's service. But we should make sure that we are giving Krishna in some form to them. We're not, so Prabhupada, you had life membership program in India. So people would give donations to temple, but he would make sure that they get some books, they get some Krishna pictures. They get something connected with Krishna in a way that they can accept and they can slowly come towards Krishna. So we cannot be insensitive to the particular situation the person is in. So the same principle applies in our own personal devotional life and in our interaction with others. So if some people are, some devotees for example, they tend to be a little more emotional. Some devotees may be a little more rational. So now, what happens in a bhakti is that we often are very quick to use the philosophy to label people. You know, if somebody who is too emotional, like, you are a sahajya, you're so sentimental. And somebody who's too rational, he says, you are a jnani, dry jnani, heartless, you know, hard-hearted. And in this way, the philosophical labels that we fix on people, they simply create barriers. They don't lead to any deeper understanding. So if somebody is more emotional, then they need to bond with people who are more emotional. Of course, the bonding has to be in such a way that they all move towards Krishna. It is not that they bond together and they say, you know, nobody cares, you know. Yeah, I also feel like this, nobody cares. And we both reinforce our own self-pity. That is undesirable. No, but we learn to understand each other better so that we can all move towards Krishna. But if we don't do this, then we may become our emotional side. We all have an emotional side. Some people may have it more, some people may have it less. Our emotional side will become a big blockage in our movement towards Krishna. So we may have resentment because somebody has neglected us. We expected something from someone and that person neglected us. So now, for different people, their emotions may need to be processed in different ways. Some people feel, even in devotional circles, some people feel lonely. Now, there is association of devotees, but Bhaktivedanta Thakur says we need like-minded association. If we don't have like-minded association, we may be among devotee circle, but we may feel lonely. Now, somebody may tell, oh, you're feeling lonely, just do more service, loneliness will go away. Now, that may work. But if that does, it can work. Sometimes we just too much caught in the mind. We start getting out of the mind, start doing practical things, it goes away. But if it doesn't go away, then they may need some people who understand them, they talk with them, sit with them a little bit, understand them, and then they feel better and then they start working. So now it is whatever our emotional nature is, that doesn't necessarily mean it is a deficiency. It is just the way we are. And we need to work from where we are towards Krishna. If somebody is very rational, that doesn't mean that they are jnanis. Rationality is also a faculty that can be used in Krishna's service. So, some people may not be particularly, they don't get into emotions so much. It's fine, but then they need to connect with others who are similar and move onwards towards Krishna. So we need to acknowledge our particular emotional nature and then use it in Krishna's service. We don't work for it. That means just because working for it means, no, oh, I feel that, no, I have a very emotional nature. I feel that people don't care for me. And nobody has time for me. Nobody wants to hear me. Nobody. So if I feel like that, and I meet 10 other people who feel like that, and all of us share our sorry stories, and all of us go deeper into mundane emotions. You know, it's like, it's not satsanga, it is self-pity sangha. You know, so our center, the purpose should be that we all come closer to Krishna. But the point is that if we work for that nature, that means we end up reinforcing that nature. We work against that nature, that means we just deny its existence. But that's a basic need which we may have. Or somebody is very rational. No, like, say some people have a lot of questions. Every philosophy, every class they have, just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 questions. You know, and somebody comes and tells them, you know, why do you have so many questions? And just chant Hare Krishna and be happy. Hell, for them, the way to the heart is through the head. Unless they are intellectually convinced, they can't take it up. Now, if that is the case for them, they have to find like-minded devotees who also think, who like to analyze, who like to explain, and then they will bond and they will flourish over there. If somebody who is, just chant Hare Krishna and be happy, that is their mood. Now, Srila Prabhupada did say chant Hare Krishna and be happy. But Prabhupada also wrote so many books. Why was that? Because the reading of the books can deepen our philosophical conviction to chant Hare Krishna and to become happy thereby. So, if somebody who is more of a, has a more of a nature of being sent, bhav, bhakti bhav, that's all is important. Not, this philosophy is not important. Well, then if somebody who has a rational nature, they can't really get much satisfactory guidance from somebody who is too much of a sentimental nature. Not sentimental in the negative sense, but just that they have more sentiments. So we all need to find the association that addresses our nature. Somebody who is rational, if a lot of rational people come together and they all can do, you know, okay, this point doesn't make sense, this point doesn't make sense, this point doesn't make sense. Then we all come together and multiply our doubts. And we all come to a conclusion, you know, this is all irrational. No, that's not what we should do. We need to associate with someone who also has a rational nature, and they rationally address our doubts. That way, we'll be able to move towards Krishna, and we'll be able to use our rational nature in the service of Krishna. When people ask questions, we'll have answers. So, we don't work against our mind, against our emotional nature. We work for Krishna, with our nature. So sometimes some devotees say that, Prabhupada said, the only problem in the world is the lack of Krishna consciousness. Just become Krishna conscious, all problems will be solved. Chanting is the solution to all problems. Yes, chanting is the solution to all problems. At the same time, the process of chanting is meant to help us develop a relationship with Krishna. And in the relationship with Krishna, we use all the faculties that we have for the service of Krishna. Now, if chanting is the solution to all problems, Valmiki Rishi could have just written Ram, 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 Ram. Why did he write 24,000 verses with the Valmiki Ramayana? He wanted us to hear that. Now, why did the sages come up with Ayurveda? Because this is also knowledge, medical knowledge, which helps us move towards Krishna. So we have to, now, some people, we may have some mental issues. Hey, I feel very lonely, I feel very bored, I feel very this, I feel very that. Chant Hare Krishna. Now sometimes chanting may address that issue. Sometimes chanting alone may not address that issue at that particular time. It's like, say, if I have got a fracture. Somebody tells me, you know, chant Hare Krishna, your fracture will go away. Well, okay. I mean, Krishna can do anything, but a devotee's mood is not that I demand that Krishna should perform miracles. A devotee's mood is, if you got a fracture, go to a doctor and take that. That's what I do. So even in the Vedic tradition, there was a system of Ayurveda. There may be some system of contemporary medicine right now. So with respect to physical fracture, I understand that, you know, it's chanting is not going to remove my physical fracture. Like going back to the earlier example, if I'm sitting on the floor and I'm chanting and I have a lot of back pain, somebody tells me, you know, just chant Hare Krishna more intensely. You will transcend your back pain. Well, that can happen, but to make that as a demand for chanting, that is unreasonable. Okay, so if I have a particular issue, I address that and I focus on Krishna. So similarly, if some people have emotional issues, they need to be addressed. We can't use chanting Hare Krishna as an excuse for not addressing the emotional issues. There are two extremes. This is a topic I will explore more elaborately in tomorrow's class. One is that we just get caught in the emotional issues and think that only after this issue is addressed, then I will chant Hare Krishna. And the other is, I think that chanting Hare Krishna alone will address the issue, and I don't consider the emotional issue at all. So we need to have a balance where we take care of our emotional health while still pursuing our spiritual health. Ultimately, whatever emotional issues we have, the ultimate solution to everything is transcending this world, is becoming absorbed in Krishna and attaining Krishna's abode. At the same time, the ultimate solution is not the only solution. I may need to have some immediate solutions, some intermediate solutions also. Now, it's only when the immediate or the intermediate solutions become a competitor to the ultimate solution, and I think this is all I need to do, then it's a problem. But we don't have to position the immediate and the intermediate solutions. What do I mean by immediate and intermediate? If I have back pain and I'm chanting Hare Krishna, I might just take some pain medicine and I pacify that pain. That's the immediate solution. Intermediate solution means I may have to go to some physical therapy, I may have to do some workout, do some exercises. That's intermediate. That may lead to some long-term solution. And the ultimate is, I have to get my consciousness out of this body and attain Krishna's abode. That's when it will be completely solved. So there are solutions at the immediate, intermediate, and the ultimate levels. So this topic of immediate, intermediate, and ultimate solutions, I'll discuss elaborately in tomorrow's class. I'll summarize and then we can have some questions. So I spoke today about emotionally healthy spirituality. That means that we have to take care of our particular emotional nature while we are pursuing spiritual growth. I talked about this Mataji who was paranoid and she heard a class about death can happen anytime, and that triggered her paranoia once again. So the knowledge of the Bhagavad Gita is not psychologically damaging. But some aspects of Bhagavad Gita's philosophical message can cause agitation to those who are already psychologically damaged. Then they have to appropriately focus. We have to hear in a purposeful way. In hearing about death, in goodness, will help us to see the temporality of the material and focus on the spiritual. Hearing about death in passion, when I'm in the mode of passion, will make me think, the material is all that exists, so let me enjoy as much as I can, as quickly as I can. In the mode of ignorance, when I feel even the material I can't control, that will just make me go into the zone of self-pity and paranoia. So just as Srila Prabhupada said, that if hearing about the Raslila, which is the highest spiritual devotional pastime, if that agitates your sensual desires, then don't hear about it. That is the reality, and the world's sensual interactions are the reflection. The reflection should direct us towards the reality. But if the reality directs us towards the reflection, then stop it. Just purify yourself. Hear the basic philosophy. Hear other pastimes of Krishna. And gradually we'll come to the level where we can hear Krishna's pastimes with the gopis also. So Annukulyasa sankalpa pratikulyasa varjanam. I need to take the responsibility to understand what is favorable for my bhakti and what is unfavorable for my bhakti. And I accept the favorable and I avoid the unfavorable.
So with respect to physical health, you talked if somebody has back pain, it's not that they have to torment their body and sit on the floor.
Sit on the chair.
So we don't work for our body, but we don't work against our body. We work with our body for Krishna.
So if I can't fast, instead of tormenting myself by fasting, I just eat what I need to and then focus on practicing bhakti. Same way, if I have a nature that is where I get too emotional, okay, that's the way I am. Then I need association which understands my emotionality and addresses it and helps me move towards Krishna. If I am very rational, fix-it kind of person, and I need the association that understands that and helps me move towards Krishna.
So a one-size-fit-all formula can actually be damaging. Preaching means to comfort the afflicted and to afflict the comforted. If we afflict the afflicted and comfort the comforted, then we are doing anti-preaching.
So similarly, we have to acknowledge our and others' particular emotional nature. And we don't work for it. That means if we work for it, it's like we're aggravating things. It's just reinforcing our particular emotional nature. We don't work against it. That means we deny it. But just like a disease that is denied, it only gets aggravated. So like a doctor sees the disease, sees the mood of the patient, and then prescribes the medicine and has a particular way in which to prescribe the medicine. So similarly, we address our particular emotional nature in a way we can move towards Krishna. And then I conclude by talking about chanting Hare Krishna is the ultimate solution to all problems. But that doesn't mean that we have to position the ultimate solution as a competitor to the immediate or the intermediate solutions. We have to balance so that we take care of our emotional health while we focus on pursuing our spiritual health. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. So are there any questions or comments? Yes, Ru.
Thank you. How to handle or help the situation when you are dealing with a person who is very emotionally challenged, very emotional person, and they may have for a period of time they have a continuous like unreasonable expectations from you. And they are dealing on an emotional level, it's not your own nature as much, but you don't want to hurt that person, or how to help the situation so that you are also not compromised.
Yeah.
And also that person can also help.
Yeah.
So if somebody is of a very emotional nature and they are, what you can say, clingy, just want to hang on, then how do we address their needs, but we don't get constricted by that. We don't, yeah. There is, there are some people who maybe have too much emotional expectations, or they may be too emotionally dependent on someone else. That kind of emotional dependency is actually not healthy. Not just in spiritual life, in general in one's life. It's not very healthy for us to be dependent on someone else too much. If my whole sense of self-identity and self-worth comes from someone else, then if that person is displeased with me, or they may not even be displeased with me, but they just don't pay attention to me or don't reciprocate the way I expect them to, that's like the end of the world for me. You know, it is, they get the question, you know, if, you know, I did this for this person, I expected this person, didn't pay attention to me. Then, like sometimes some devotees come and they say, you know, are you angry with me? Are you upset with me? Why, what happened? He says, no, last time when we were passing by, you didn't smile at me. Okay. I mean, everybody has their own issues. Normally we try to be courteous. But it's not that we have to imagine problems when there are none. Everybody is going through their own issues. So it's like we have to have our own understanding that I
am a soul who am eternally related with Krishna, and I am on a journey to Krishna. So while I am on the journey to Krishna, now I have to form relationships while I am here in this world with others. At the same time, ultimately, I am alone. So this philosophical understanding has to come in. And if some people may, as I said, may have more emotional needs, but they also, if somebody has more emotional needs, then from their side, they have to recognize that this is not very healthy for me. Because this can make me excessively dependent on others, and then that other person, if they want, they can manipulate me. By making me feel bad, they can make me do bad things. So we don't want to be manipulated by like that by others. So if somebody who has a high level of emotional dependency, they have to recognize that that is not so healthy. And they have to try to decrease that. So that decreasing can be done in two ways. One is through greater philosophical understanding, that even if they don't feel so connected to philosophy, but at least basics we understand that you know, there are some things in life which we just have to stop caring about. We can't let what anything that anyone says affect us so much. Bhakti is about developing a tender heart. But to practice bhakti in this world, we not only have to develop a tender heart, we also have to cover that tender heart with a thick skin. We need a thick skin. So if we are very thin-skinned, that means somebody does small thing, we get too disturbed by that. So all of us have to, whatever level we are at, we have to thicken our skin a little bit. That means I have to find out some activities by way, philosophically I understand that this is unhealthy for me. This level of emotional dependency is unhealthy for me. Then based on that understanding, I try to decrease it as much as I can. And the way to decrease it is by trying to find out some engagements, some ways of acting and functioning, which give me fulfillment without a need, without a dependence on external validation. A Brahmana, for example, is an intellectual. And a Brahmana loves to study and loves to share that knowledge. And naturally, if somebody is Brahminical, when they share the knowledge, if others appreciate that knowledge, they'll be appreciated. They'll be happy. Because yes, what I was sharing is appreciated by others. But a Brahmana is such a person that even if nobody hear, there's nobody to hear the knowledge that they're speaking, still they will study. Because that study itself gives them satisfaction. So now, by this definition, we can say none of us are Brahmanas. Most of us study because we have to speak. That's how we are. We come from a very Rajasic background. But we can find out, are there any activities? Just doing that activity itself gives me satisfaction. There are devotees who just do deity worship for years. And they don't really care who knows that I'm doing so much deity worship or not. Naturally, there's a human need for appreciation. If somebody appreciates, that's nice. But just the activity itself gives satisfaction. So we have to find what that activity is. Where the need for reciprocation is not so much, where the absorption in the activity itself gives satisfaction. So once we find that, then that will fulfill some of our needs without us needing someone else. We do naturally need appreciation from others, but that's not the driving force. That's not the sole driving force. Just the connection which we establish. Yes, this is what I love to do. So finding some activity which we can absorb ourselves in, that is important. And secondly, if a person has a lot of emotional needs, then it is good for them to also find out someone who is of that nature. Even if there's one person like that, it makes a big difference. So within the devotee community, there are, as I said, devotees of different natures. And we have various relationships which work in various ways. So we can, in a traditional family setting, people, when they had joint families, now the different needs were taken care of by different people. You go to something for your mother, you go to something for your grandmother, you go for something to your cousin, you go for something to your sibling. We have different needs are taken care of by different relationships. Now when we have nuclear families, what happens is that all those needs are taken care of by different people. Now we expect it all from one person, our spouse. If that's the major family that we have, if we are just alone. And it's just too much pressure on that relationship. Now that's why if we are a part of a community, where there is the community becomes like a greater family. And some of our emotional needs are taken care by our other relationships in the community. Then that also helps us to fulfill our needs in a way. We have to, of course, take care that we fulfill the needs in a way that is dharmic, in a way that is conducive for our devotional life. But trying to find even one relationship like that, where our emotional needs are addressed, and then nurturing that relationship. Now, some relationships may be easily developable, in the sense that, you know, we work together, we do services together, we live close by. And that's why we have relationships. But some relationships may require some work. It may be that, you know, we don't get to meet each other. But still, if there's a lot of bonding that happens in a particular relationship, then we take the time to spend, to meet, we make the effort to find the time, to make the time, and spend time together. So, I'm more of an intellectual nature. So then there are a few devotees in different parts of the world who I bonded with. So then once I bond with those devotees, then even if I don't get to meet them, sometimes I meet them once a year, but then nowadays with technology, with social media, you know, we talk regularly, we discuss various things, bounce off our ideas, and that devotee is a writer, I am a writer. Then we make time to spend time together, whatever way. So if we find that a particular relationship is addressing our particular need, then we may have to take the time to develop that relationship. So it's often relationships that are like trees. You know, we have to water them initially, and then they will shelter us eventually. But if we don't water them, and we say, this is so small, there's no shelter over here. Well, you never watered it. So both ways, by finding an absorbing service and by finding some connection with some relationship which takes care of our particular emotional need, that emotional dependency can be addressed. Okay? Thank you. Any other questions? Yes, Madhavi.
You mentioned the last class where it's like opposite to love is neglect, not to pay. So it's a slow process. So my question is actually, in any case you face neglect, that may be working on mission or somewhere else, like there is neglect there knowingly, unknowingly. So what shall we do in that situation? How should we
if we have faced neglect in a particular relationship, then whether it's knowing or unknowing, intentional or unintentional, but what should we do in that situation? Yes. Emotional health means that we don't have negative emotions clogging the channel of our consciousness towards Krishna. When water is flowing along a particular channel, if something is blocking it, water cannot flow. Like that, sometimes emotional issues, they block the channel of our consciousness. Even if I come in front of the deities and I'm trying to pray, but I'm thinking, you know, why did this devotee do like that? Why did this happen? Why did it speak like that? Why did it speak like that? So now, if this is blocking, then we have to deal with the blockage. So normally, what can be done? In every relationship, there are three aspects. I am there, the other person is there, and the interaction is there. So now, in some cases, just the interaction is the problem. Some cases, the other person is the problem. Some cases, I am the problem. That means, say, like somebody would say, are you angry with me? He says, why? You didn't smile at me at that time. Well, okay, you know, I just caught in my thoughts. So I forgot about it. I'm sorry. There's something wrong in the interaction. It was very circumstantial. That's how it happened. And don't take it so seriously. That's one thing. But the other could be that something is wrong with that person. That means either that person is angry with me and is deliberately neglecting me, or that person has a nature by which they are not sensitive to such nuances and they just neglect. So either way, we may have to address it. So generally, when addressing issues like this, it's best to function in the mode of goodness. That means separate. I talked earlier about the mode of goodness. In the retreat, I mentioned that it means to separate the emotion from the action, emotion from the situation. Okay, you know, instead of saying, you know, you are so uncaring, you are so neglectful, rather than saying that, start with the fact. You know, when you did not come on time, or when you arrived late, or when you forgot to get this, I felt very upset. Because this was so important for me, like this. So when we start with facts, we don't deny our feelings, we don't minimize our feelings. But basically, as I said, in the interaction, there is the action that happened, there's the feeling that I experienced, and there is the judgment I made about the other person. My judgment is that this person is so uncaring. Whenever we have to address emotional issues, frequently, we start with a judgment. Now, you are so irresponsible, you are so forgetful, you are so insensitive. And then as soon as a label comes on anyone, they just can't digest it. They become defensive. And then both people start fighting the label. You know, you are like this. No, I'm not like that. They say, you are so insensitive. No, I did this for you. How can I be insensitive? Then you say, no, you did not do this. And it becomes like a war where the issue is forgotten. So instead of, our mind may come up with some label based on certain behavior. But if we have to communicate, never start with the label. In fact, as far as possible, don't bring in the label only. Start with the fact, start with the action, start with the situation. And then we can tell our emotion. And then after that, we can tell the reason for the emotion. So start with the action, tell the emotion, and then tell the reason for the emotion. So, when you didn't come for the program, I felt angry because you had an important service in the program and we didn't know who will do that service, whatever it is. So, this way, when we communicate in the mode of goodness, then that person at least understands where we are coming from, why we are feeling the way we are feeling. And then based on their response, we can appropriately choose. Sometimes they may, even after we present the facts, they just don't understand. Then we have to understand that this is the way this person is. Now, they can also try to change. Now, nobody normally wants, especially in close relationship, nobody wants to intentionally hurt another person. Sometimes we may do something which we know hurt the other person, but we do it because of some pettiness. You hurt me last time, I'll hurt you now. But there is no malevolence over there. We don't wish ill on the other person. It's just that time, the negativity may spurt out. So, if we express ourselves clearly, non-judgmentally, then, I didn't know that it was so important for you. This is so important. Yes, I'll take care of it in future. So then, that way, we can overcome that feeling of neglect. Or we can give the person the information by which they can overcome the feeling of neglect. Sometimes, two different people just have two different considerations of what is important. The thing may be very important for person A, but for person B, it's not that important. But then if person A says, this is so important for me, and why it is so important, then person B can adjust and take care of it. So then if they change, that's good. Then the neglect can be addressed that way. We see in the pastime of Dhruva Maharaj, because Maharaj Uttanapad was so infatuated with Suruchi that he did not realize the impact that his neglect was going to have on Dhruva. But later on, when Dhruva left home and went away, then Uttanapad realized the gravity of what he had done. And then he started lamenting, "What have I done?" At that time, Narad Muni came and he told him that your son is going to do something illustrious. He's meditating, he's going to become a great devotee and he will come back soon. So he pacified him. But basically the point is that he realized the gravity of his neglect after some time, when some action happened, some consequence of that action came up. So sometimes that is the way people learn. Now the neglect, that it has some consequence, then they learn it. But it's better to learn through communication than through consequence. Now, this is where the other person, so first is this an incidental neglect, circumstantial, that we don't have to take so seriously. Something is because that person is desensitized, then we have to make them sensitized to that situation. But if they're just not ready to be sensitized, then we have to decrease our expectation. Bhaktivedanta Thakur gives a definition of humility which is extremely difficult to apply. But it can give us a pointer in which to move forward. He says, humility means to have no expectation from anyone. Humility means to have no expectation from anyone. It's very difficult to live in that way, but we can see that, okay, it is not this, okay, this person is like this, but I needn't have this expectation from them. Let's see how we can function in other ways. That person may be doing some other things, but this just doesn't register in them. Then we have to adjust ourselves. So we need to feel valued, cared, but from where that will come, sometimes we may expect a particular way of being valued or cared for from a particular person. But just because it doesn't come from that person doesn't mean that that person doesn't value or care for us. It's just that they may be valuing and caring in a different way. So we have to learn to appreciate the way they are valuing and caring. And if we need valuing and caring in some other way, we have to find out within the broader devotee community from some other devotees, we may get that. So we have to, now if we feel neglected, we have to address that. And addressing that is our responsibility. It is not the other person's responsibility. Yes, the other person can and ideally speaking should do something to address it. But if they don't do, what can I do? I cannot let myself become a victim of someone else's neglect. So if somebody is neglectful, then I have to do what it takes to have my needs addressed so that I can move towards Krishna. So we have to take responsibility for our emotional health. And say like, somebody has got an infectious disease in our family or in our immediate vicinity. Now they have got that disease, but I can't say, you know, you have that disease, that's your problem. Well, yes, if I can help you cure that disease, that's fine. But at least I have to take care that I don't get that infectious disease. And so similarly, if taking care of our physical health is our responsibility, without unnecessarily judging someone that you are sick and you are giving me your bad health. But similarly, our emotional health is our responsibility. And we have to see how we can take care of it. Does that address your question? Thank you. Any other questions? Yes, Prabhu.
You spoke about opening up emotionally to some other devotees. So if you feel at some time that you are being judged, yeah, for like among devotees, just because you might come from a liberal background according to material history, so how to deal with that?
Yes. Now, if while opening up with someone we feel judged, then what should we do? Yes. Guhyam akhyati pruchyati. That revealing our heart in confidence and hearing another reveal their heart in confidence. That is one of the, it is two of the sixfold loving exchanges that Rupa Goswami talks about in the Bhakti Rasamrita, in the Upadesha Amrita, Nectar of Instruction. So now, we have to understand that we have to find the right people for doing the sharing of the heart. It's like with respect to prasad. Now, I may cook a very delicious sweet, and I may offer it to someone, but if that person has diabetes, then now that person will have to say no, and I cannot see that as a personal rejection. He says, no, I have diabetes, I can't take it. So that reciprocation of cooking some sweet and offering, that is a reciprocation of love. But it has to be done with the right person. If I do it with the wrong person, then it will not work. Similarly, giving gifts, taking gifts. No, if we give a precious, or maybe a jewel from the altar to a child, and the child loses it, he says, it's a deity's jewel, okay, I lost it. But you cannot give it to them. So, just as the other two interactions, giving and receiving gifts and giving and receiving prasadam, that has to be done with the right person. Similarly, sharing our heart has to be done with the right person. So, if a woman is alone at home and somebody knocks on the door, now she may first look to the peephole, who is there? Look to the security camera. Or if there is a chain, open the door a little bit and see who is there. It's a familiar person, then they open the door fully and let them in. Otherwise, they don't let them in. So that's a basic security for one's own protection. So similarly, you know, we cannot open the door of our heart suddenly to anyone. So we may speak some small point and see their response. And if you feel that they're judging, then we decide, you know, I can't open the door over here. That doesn't mean we never open the door, but we have to find out with whom I can open the door. You know, I speak, I felt so hurt when that devotee spoke like this. Hey, don't be so sentimental, man. Somebody's saying that means they're not understanding it. And that's fine. That is just the way they are. And I can't open up with them. So we have to find out with whom we can open in a way that we won't be judged and labeled. Now, we can't expect, and we shouldn't expect that other persons will simply pamper and help us rationalize what we have done. If there's something wrong, that person has to tell it. And you know, if you say, just, you have to accept me the way I am, and this is the way I'm going to stay. No, we have to accept each other for the way we are. But we can't accept that this is the way I'm going to stay. You know, we all have to have some willingness to change, willingness to become better. So, there is judging and there is discriminating. The word discrimination has a lot of negative connotation nowadays. Like we have racial discrimination, gender discrimination. So I prefer the word discerning. You know? Discerning. So some discerning has to be done. So if we share our heart with someone and that person discerns, you should not have acted this way. Or this is what you could have done at this time. This was right, this was wrong. Now that can be done in an educational way, it can be done in a judgmental way. Judgmental way means what happens is that person equates us with the behavior. Oh, you are so lazy, you are so this, you are so that. But discerning means you separate the person from the behavior, but at the same time tell this behavior is not right. And this is what you can do to correct it. So we have to open our hearts it's a responsibility to open our hearts so that we can get guidance, but it's also a responsibility to find out with whom I can open the heart. And that for that we have to test the pulse a little bit, open the heart a little bit. And once we find out the right person, then we can open our heart fully. Okay. So thank you very much. Shri Radhaval Bhagwan ki, Gaunitai Bhagwan ki, Srinath Baldev Subhadramaya ki. So, thank you very much. Shri Prabhupada ki, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki, Gaur Premanandi.